We're going to talk today about creating an inclusive environment. I would like to first start with a picture, and since we are not able to interact here, when I show this picture in most of my sessions and I ask them what is visible, more number of times the response that I get is a wheelchair, a child or a person using a wheelchair. And a few people do respond about how the person is trying to manipulate or move the wheelchair on their own. So primarily when we look at disability or a person with special needs, the first thing that comes to our mind is the inability to do things or the devices or assistance that they are using. Why is this? This is because over the centuries in India especially, we have been now using the medical model. So the medical model is the model where we look at things as a problem that needs to be fixed or changed. So when we look at people with disabilities, we look at people who have problems or impairments, confined to wheelchair, unable to hear, not able to see, they need help. They might require medication, they need to depend on other people, they can't walk, they can't see, they can't talk, and so on, they can't read. The other model is, of course, the social model of disability, where most of the developed nations have now moved on to, where the issue is looked at from the social point of view of a disabling environment, the attitudes that are there towards these people, the barriers they face, the discrimination they face. So we have things that we can work upon. We can look at transport, which needs to be made accessible. We need to look at their support. Maybe poverty is the disabling environment. What about the attitudes of people? Inaccessible buildings, inaccessible curriculum. So anything that can be rectified. That is where our inclusion word sets in, creating an inclusive environment. So when we look at the medical model versus the social model, instead of looking at the individual as a problem, instead of looking at the individual who needs to change, we look at the barriers which need to be removed, the information which needs to be made available to them, and what can be done in the society to make it more inclusive. So here we come across three main terms: an impairment, a handicap, and a disability. I'm sure many of you may be knowing the differences. For the uninitiated, an impairment is usually one of organic nature. It could be congenital or maybe acquired later. So there could be a physical impairment, there could be a sensory impairment, which can be a visual or an auditory impairment. This impairment leads to a functional disability in an individual. Because of the impairment, the person is unable to see, to walk, to read, and hence has a disability. But if there is an environment in which they cannot have access, for example, a curriculum which they are not able to utilize, a building which they are not able to get into, then it becomes a handicap. When we change the environment, when we make it inclusive, when we make it accessible, the disability can be removed. The disability can be overcome. The impairment might still be there, but they can still be a productive, functional adult or a child in the society. So that is where creating an inclusive environment comes from. Since we are all dealing with education, I'm starting with what is inclusive education. I will be talking about what, why, and how. So what is inclusive education? It is the process of increasing the participation of all learners. Nobody gets left behind. Exclusion from different cultures, curricula, communities, everything is taken, is removed. How is it possible? It involves the restructuring of policies, practices, and particularly in schools, ensuring that diverse learners have access to education. So inclusion definitely means including children with disabilities, but it also means children from various diverse economic, socio backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, language backgrounds. Anything that causes, gives them a barrier, we will work at removing that and include them. So hence, there will be no exclusions due to behavioral issues, disabilities, diversities in any of the backgrounds. So therefore, inclusion is also concerned with improving schools for staff as well as for learners, so that all learners can participate in the least restrictive environment, most important. Here, when we create an inclusive environment, we will not look at as a problem, diversity or a disability to be overcome. It's not a problem. It is a rich resource. How can we include more people? How can we support learning? And when we start with inclusive education and start building networking and sustaining relationships with the community, very soon we will have an inclusive community. India is not new to diversity. We have had a rich culture of diverse learners, and in some of my talks with very, very renowned educationists, I know people who are doing research on the kind of learning that was done during Vedic age and how a teacher was supposed to take care of high capacity students, medium capacity students, and low capacity students. Somewhere along the line, we have turned towards exclusion, and it's time to change that. So given by UNESCO, inclusive education must recognize and respond to diverse needs by accommodation. We must recognize different styles, different rates of learning, and the same quality education has to be provided to everyone by appropriate curricula, by changing the organizational arrangements, teaching strategy, resource use, and definitely by partnering with communities. Why do we need it? Because inclusion leads to dignity. Inclusion leads to independence. Every person in the society has a right to independent living and a life of dignity. Our today's students are going to be our citizens for tomorrow. Inclusion ensures that children with and without disabilities understand diversity, accept it, and embrace it. So children studying in inclusive schools are not really bothered if they have a child with disability or a child from a different background or a different language or a culture sitting right next to them. In life, when they come across diversity or barriers, they have already learned as students to look at it from a different perspective and to overcome these barriers. How do we do it? Now, this is the process that we have to talk about, that how creating an inclusive environment at the national level. We have some policies which are the latest ones that I'm talking about. The RPWD Act, Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act, which came about in 2016. It is a detailed document given by the Government of India, where the number of disabilities was increased from 7 to 21. It is available on the net, so I have not included in my presentation. But it gives the details of how the rights need to be honored. Chapter 3 deals with inclusive education, where detailing of what kind of schools, accessibility, teacher training, accommodation is spelled out for both central as well as local governments. There is also flexibility in saying any new adaptations and accommodations may be embraced. Of course, the national policy, educational policy, which has just come up, 2020, the much talked about policy now, has in paragraph 6.1 talked about equitable and inclusive education. They talk about inclusion of Divyangjan as well as all genders, and definitely address cultural background. With these policies as our main background, the schools can frame their own inclusive policies. CBSE in its own way has come up with wonderful guidelines. The latest one in September, first week of September, has clear standard operating procedures spelled out for each of the disability, the benchmark disabilities. They have grown from strength to strength, where they started with changing of the bylaws way back in 2002 to 2020 now, where they have given additional subjects at high secondary level. A lot of vocational subjects have been introduced. Doing away with more than one language is an option that the schools can embrace. Extra time, provision of scribe, assistive devices like computers, and the latest, the calculator has been introduced. Also, a two-level mathematical approach, a basic and advanced. So as the main educational board of the country, CBSE has brought in several inclusive reforms. The next thing that we can do to create an inclusive environment is the accessible and barrier-free physical structure. So Smart Cities and Inclusive India campaign has been on. There was a deadline by 2018 for all major cities and all government buildings to be accessible. It has been extended now. It was extended to 2019, and this year there has been further extension to ensure audit of the buildings are carried out, and it is ensured that the buildings have ramps, elevators, lifts, so that all floors are accessible to people. We have a lot of journey to cover here. Our transport needs to be accessible. Our signals need to be accessible, and there is a lot more to be done. But we can get there step by step by moving one, taking a one step at a time. Now, some of the buildings that I have visited claim to be accessible. They have the lifts, but when you look at it very closely, a wheelchair cannot enter those lifts. Now, that is not what we call inclusion. Just for the sake of ticking a box, it is not going to help. So one has to keep in mind that when it comes to schools, every part of the school has to be accessible to all children with benchmark disabilities. The main gate, the stage where an assembly could be performed, the toilets at every floor, the laboratories, the libraries, books, whether they are accessible to the people with visual impairment, hearing impairment. The schools can take up one disability at a time and work towards making it accessible, and very soon we will find that it has become a barrier-free and inclusive school. Next, coming to the accessible curriculum. This is one of the major part of having an inclusive school, where children are finding their way into the classrooms, but are they actually benefiting? Are they able to learn from the curriculum? Are they participating? There are new approaches to pedagogy, like the Universal Design for Learning. I'm sure there is a session planned on that. There could be differential instruction, where the curriculum is planned from the beginning in advance. Before implementation, the teacher looks at the student in the classroom, verifies and makes an account of their strengths and weaknesses, and prepares the curriculum so that everybody has access to it. It is not about lowering standards. It is about creating standards for everybody to achieve, and also having scaffolding for those who cannot and those who are high achievers. So when we talk of inclusion, it is not just people with disabilities or students with disabilities. We also take into account the students who are high functioning, the gifted ones, who may find the regular class uninteresting and unstimulating. So when the teacher is taking all of this into consideration before planning her lesson plan, the curriculum becomes accessible. How is it possible? This has to be done through capacity building and sensitizing principals, school heads, the policy makers, the school management to begin with, so that they understand that student achievement and high grades and the board results are not all in all, ensuring that the children do not get left behind is also the main target of education. Pre-service and in-service teacher training programs are much needed to create an inclusive environment. Many of the degrees, our B.Ed. programs are going to be revamped under the NEP 2020. But even before that, we have undergrad degrees in education and in special education, where mainstreaming and inclusion are essential components of the teacher training programs. What about the vast number of teachers who are already in jobs teaching the inclusive classrooms? Well, programs like these are the answer to it. Through in-service training, teachers can be sensitized, teachers need to be supported. Small incremental changes in the curriculum can, over a period of time, lead to wonderful inclusive changes. Here, one of the main components is that since our classrooms are huge and diversity is already the norm, it is always important to have special educators in the school as per the number of special needs children in the classroom. This will help in collaboration between a special educator and a regular educator. The special educators can no longer remain content with working along with only the special needs students. Their role is now a bigger role. They need to play the role of a leader. They need to collaborate between all the stakeholders, teachers, special educators, parents, Divyangjan, all the students, because now their role is that of an inclusive teacher. And the final but the most important part is the evaluation and monitoring. Whenever we set some practices into motion, it is important that we evaluate it at regular intervals. We set the pace, we try and find out what has gone wrong, what has worked, and learn from the errors that we have made and bring in new changes. So we will follow some of the principles for developing inclusive environment. One is respecting learners with different abilities, values, diverse talents, and their socio backgrounds, economic backgrounds, and their histories. Today, we have children who have different sexual orientation, with different disabilities, speaking various languages in the classroom. It is important that the special educator and the general education teacher treat them all alike and with respect. Also, that each one of them have unique talent. They may have a unique need or some additional challenge which needs to be addressed, and that has to be brought into the curriculum and the policy of the school, and only then will the change be possible. The learning environment has to be friendly. Again, one of the main giveaways of the NEP 2020, flexibility, environment friendly, learning friendly, child friendly. Only then there is a growth. If there is a program which is not friendly to children with disabilities, it is not going to be inclusive. How is this going to be possible? This is going to be plausible only when we use multiple learning approaches. We cannot have one size fits all. We cannot make the children change as in the medical model. And a few examples of this I've already mentioned, how CBSE has been encouraging children to take up vocational courses, career-oriented courses like tourism, retail, even artificial intelligence is on the cards or it has been already introduced. So fashion designing, legal studies, there are so many courses that have been introduced for the children. Also allowing them extra time, giving them flexible approaches like multiple choice questions. All this is there for us to embrace, for us to make sure that our schools are following as a policy to create an inclusive policy at the beginning of every year. The universal design principles, the very word universal is suggesting that everybody is included, nobody is left behind. The UDL pedagogy given by Dr. David Rose from Harvard University is something that can be easily adapted to the Indian context, considering the diverse needs that we have. When I have studied the curriculum in detail over the last few years, UDL is not something new to us. We have already been doing a lot of accommodations, modifications, adaptations, but probably it has not been given the name UDL. So when I train teachers and I talk to them about creating accessible classes, then they are already doing their bit. They are already bringing in new material. So it is not that we are teaching them or taking them along a new path. Here, what I want to say is, when we look at creating accessible classes or universal material, let material not be exclusive to children with disabilities. It needs to be something that everybody in the class can utilize, participate, enjoy, so that the child who is different does not feel as if he is a unique person in the class doing something different when the rest of the class is actually doing something else. Use of technology cannot be understated. When we say technology, many people confuse it with smart boards, with digital technology. Well, anything that helps in a child learning is technology as far as I am concerned. Starting from a gripper that can be put onto a pencil for a child who has a grasping problem, or maybe a change in the height of the chair to help the child sit properly, a child with maybe physical impairment, to having talking books, audiovisual aids, smart classes where PowerPoint presentation can be flashed, to using calculators, laptop, having screen reading software. So we can move from low grade technology to mid to high grade technology, depending on the needs of the learners, depending on the resources of the school, depending on the funds that every institution want to set aside to ensure that technology is available to everybody and not just the child with special needs. Reducing barriers within the learning environments. Once again, I said the barriers are there in the environment. All this while we have been looking at the child who is having the problems. That is the medical model. The social models will start evaluating the barriers. Is my class only a discussion class where I am not showing any learning materials? Can I make it more participatory? Can I make it a little more interactive, interdisciplinary? Experiential learning is being advocated by CBSE very, very strongly. Can I bring it into the class? Can I help the children learn by themselves? Can I trust them to make errors and learn from it? One of the factors where, when we reduce barriers while dealing with children with disabilities or otherwise, is the teacher need not be the only person who is doing an audit of the barriers. It is important that we train our children to look at the barriers they are facing. Only then we can make them the expert learners, which is given by the SDGs, the Millennium Sustainable Development Goals given by United Nations, talks about every child being an expert learner. What does that mean? As a learner, I should know what are the problems that I am facing. Can I communicate that to my teacher? Can I help my teacher teach me better? This way, I will be a lifelong learner. In our culture, we do have this problem of the teacher knowing everything and the child just having to listen. The guru will impart knowledge. There has to be a shift in the paradigm. The guru still exists. The teacher is still the almighty. But we have to empower our learners of the millennium. We have to teach them to talk for themselves, to communicate, to tell the teacher, if you teach me in this way, I can learn better. This is an ongoing process. This is not going to happen in 1 or 2 days. It's not going to happen in 1 or 2 years also. Each child learns at a different pace. But in my experience, I have seen that children with disabilities also, over a period of time, when given a chance to talk about the barriers they are facing, can easily communicate by the time they reach middle school and upper middle school. That is exactly what we want. high expectations for all learners, including children with disabilities. Let us not have a half-hearted approach or a very poor expectation from a child with disability. We need to ensure that we have the highest level of expectations from every learner in the class. That is the dignity they deserve. In some of my observations in the US classrooms, I came across a teacher who was working with severely impacted children who were in the classrooms, intellectual disabilities, as well as a couple of them had autism. And she was teaching them sustainable development. It came as a shock to me, because sometimes we just think of exempting them from science and maths and giving them vocational subjects. But then she told me, I just bring it down to their level. She had done a very simple thing. She had just put two colored dustbins in her classroom, a green and a blue that we are all familiar with. And she was trying to teach her children to segregate biodegradable and non-biodegradable material. She brought down the level to plastic. She used images to help them understand what is biodegradable. She used images to help them non-biodegradable understand the phenomenon. Showed them videos every day. Placed posters on the dustbin so that they could see it and then they could practice it. And she kept a period allotted immediately after the lunch break to help the children segregate it. And after 6 months, she said even her severely impacted intellectually disabled children were able to do it almost up to 50% efficiency, which I think is wonderful considering that many of us with so-called normal intelligence don't do it in our community, still in India. So one thing I learned from that special educator was that do not lower the expectation. It is up to the teacher to bring it down to the level of the child, but keep the goal as high as possible. One of the main things which I've learned for inclusion to succeed is collaboration. The special educator is going to play a huge role in collaboration because she needs to collaborate with the teachers, the cluster resource person in the district level, the medical professionals if the child has epilepsy or any other underlying medical conditions, the paraprofessionals, also with organizations working with children with disabilities, with parents, with siblings, with peers. It is important to understand that the child is the main focus. Neither the special educator nor the general education teacher nor the parent is the most important person. It is the child who is important. And it is teamwork definitely gives rise to some beautiful inclusive practices. A general school teacher sometimes resists inclusion. This is because she already has a lot on her platter. She has to adhere to a diverse classroom. She has to report to her superiors. She's answerable for falling grades. She's answerable for the school average grade, which the management is concerned about. She has to plan lessons. She has to collect fees, money, so many things. And in this scenario, when I'm expecting her to handle diverse ability students, it is wonderful if she can have an extra pair of hands to help her. So if there is a teacher who is resisting inclusion, it is a cry for help. We must recognize it that she needs help to provide her with extra help, a special educator, maybe a support teacher, maybe a parent help, maybe a peer who is willing to go that extra way. So considering all of this, our policies are more or less in place. We have them. But the only thing is that we need to add to the human side and the material resource. So this is possible only through systematic planning, collaboration, and empathy. Everybody's contributions have to be valued. The teacher cannot say that the parent is not working or the parent cannot say the school is not doing enough. Everybody has to be on the side of the child. We are all on the same side, as I often tell my parents. We are all partners in making sure that the children are succeeding. For example, if I have to exempt a child from a particular subject, I ensure that the parent is in the loop of the decision making, the teacher who has been teaching, the child themselves. A 13 to 14 year old child has to be told and asked whether they would like to be exempted from a subject. what would be the repercussions, what is the roadmap, and we have to be accountable for the outcomes. Positive or negative, we have to be accountable. Sharing of resources, time, expertise, space, equipment is not something that I need to really emphasize upon. In a country like India, where we have limited resources, it is not possible to have resources only for a select group of few. That is why the universal component is important when we talk of inclusive education. The other important components is the relationship with children. Treat the children with dignity. They can make small decisions. They like to voice their opinion. Let them not just be physically present in the class. Let them be an essential part of the class. Ensuring that they are there in the assemblies, in the extracurricular activities, in the school picnics, trips. If there is additional help required, we must prepare ourselves for it. Composition of the class. It is important to see that every class has equal distribution of gender diversity, disability, of other backgrounds. If there is concentration of one kind of diversity in a class, it may not be really having a great inclusive atmosphere, because the children then start associating one class with inclusion and the other classes to be a little different. The number of children in every class and the teacher-student ratio definitely needs to be considered. Seating arrangements. Often I have seen teachers, in well-meaning teachers, making the children sit right in the front, but the children don't like it. They also want to be sitting with their friends, with their peers. The learning part, we have talked about the curriculum adaptations. There will be other sessions in detail. And most important is the evaluation. How are the children going to be evaluated? We should not be compromising with the learning standards and the learning outcomes. So the evaluation has to be pre-planned. There are, of course, barriers to inclusion, physical or architectural, as we have spoken about. Every part of the society and the school included should be accessible. An audit needs to be done and it can be taken care of. The education system, the systemic barrier also is one of the biggest barriers to inclusive education. Whether it is the outcomes can be similar, but the methodologies can be different. So usually teachers and school heads sometimes face a problem in changing the methodology because they fear the outcomes may be different. That is not true. With planning, the outcomes can be the same. And of course, the attitudinal barriers, which think that the child needs to be fixed and not the system. That is something that we need to chip away by and by. I would like to conclude by saying that inclusive teaching is not lowering expectations or eliminating an answer choice or making things easy or even trying to say that a teacher is a bad teacher. Not at all. Every teacher wants to give her best. She just wants to ensure that all children succeed. Instead, inclusive teaching is creative teaching to ensure that, yes, every child is having access, problem solving. Giving an opportunity to a child to show how they have learned, demonstrate, and making instruction accessible. Thank you very much once again. I hope my short session has been of use. I take it over to the moderator and I invite questions. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for giving such an exhaustive description and the guidelines for inclusive changes in school environment. Not only the policies and principles, but also the actionables. Only we teachers can understand what is to be done. So, ma'am, this is a question from my side, since I have also been a teacher. So whenever we try to include, means the inclusion, means the normal children and the children with disabilities, it's very difficult to, you know, make them one or like create an environment where both of them can stay together in a classroom. It is always a confrontation or a segregation type of an environment. So how can we improve on it?
Thank you. That's a wonderful question, ma'am. And it is something that the teacher is always concerned about. I have faced a lot of this in the classrooms. And you are right. Now, my observation and understanding is that children always model what the adults do. Our students have seen the adults in their life, teachers and parents discriminating. So they are probably doing the same. It may not be all teachers and all parents, but yes, definitely some teachers and some parents. So inclusion, as I said, definitely involves peers also. Peers have to be taken along. Before including a child in the classroom, it is always better to sensitize the classroom, to talk about a particular disability, to talk about the terminologies depending on the class. In the primary classes, you will not find segregation at all. Children do not discriminate. Almost up to class 2 or 3, they are just taken along with the peers. It is from class 3, class 4, when the identity, the self, I begins, that they want to associate with the high achievers, with the brighter ones, because their parents have started drilling this into them, or because the school also invariably talks about good result, good marks. So the children who are not doing well, or the children who are not able to play games well, or who are not able to talk well, are not good enough. Classes 3, 4, 5, 6, I find a lot of discrimination. Class 7, 6th upwards, I feel that the children have the capacity to understand and to learn that we should take people along. I'm not saying that classes 3, 4, 5, 6 do not have. In these classes also, you will find that there are sensible and sensitive children who want to be a part of the inclusion. So there we tap 3 or 4 children in a particular group. But class 6, 7, 8 upwards, I can take over the whole class. 40 to 40 children can participate in understanding about disabilities, in correcting other children if they misbehave. And ninth upwards, again, I see that inclusion, I don't have to step in. The children are already there because they have grown up together. And it is a beautiful thing to see children talk about awareness, children sensitizing. Days like Mental Health Day, World Disability Day should be utilized to create awareness in the classroom. I often have activities in my school where I make children walk blindfolded, or I make them listen to Jaws and write down, or I give them a mirror and ask them to read a book, just to sensitize them how the person sitting next to you is facing the problem. So these are some of the things we need to do and on your ongoing day.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I have not received any more questions, but one more question. When we talk about inclusivity, even if we engage special educators, we have got different types of, you know, problems with the children. Like autism, and someone has speech problem, one has hearing problem. So there are limitations in our schools. We cannot have more than one special educator or two special educators. So they are not able to address to all the problems of all types of disabilities. So what could be
the solution?
Yes.
You're right, ma'am. Because our courses in special education have been designed on the basis of different categories, be it in hearing impairment, be it in visual impairment, diploma courses in intellectual disability. That is how the courses were designed in the last two decades. Now we are moving towards inclusion. But my stand is that when I started off in an inclusive school, I had a degree only in intellectual disability. Then I upgraded to also hearing impairment, specific disability, autism. Just like a general education teacher is allowed to upgrade herself in teaching and so many other things, a special educator who is in a mainstream inclusive school, or all special educators from time to time, need to upgrade on the other disabilities. Not in in-depth knowledge, but definitely a little bit knowledge is required. Also, they must collaborate and network with different organizations which are working with specific disabilities. For example, we have two children with multiple disabilities and I do not know much. So I hold hands with Sense International, which is there in Delhi. The professionals from there come and help me. They help me to assess. They help me to plan the programs. Earlier, I was associating with NAB. So a special educator's collaboration, which I talked about, is important. One cannot be master of all trades, but we can be a jack of many trades. And that is what the management should support. And of course, to have more than one special educator is definitely a luxury in an inclusive school. One another thing which directorate allows is for a school to choose some categories of disability. Like I can decide that my school will cater to physical and autistic children because my special educators are sound in it. Some other school can then take up visual impairment and intellectual disability. That is for the policy makers and the government to see that within a given area, there are schools available for inclusion of different categories. So inclusion is a multi-layered, multi-tasked approach. We cannot have just one kind of solution for the problems. These are my understandings of inclusion, whatever I have learned in the past few years.
Now, so it's a very good answer, wonderful. Because we must coordinate and collaborate with different schools. And
definitely.
It can be decided that one particular school caters to one type of, right?
To begin with. Later on, they can add.
Yes, ma'am. One question that has come is that what type of projects can be assigned to these children so that the activity is inclusive in a class?
Wonderful question. Again, all projects, the sky is the limit. When you have project-based learning or projects that you're allotting, you should ensure that within a given group, there has to be children who are high functioning and children who need help. So they can choose where they can demonstrate their learning. And as I said, let the teacher not decide how the child will demonstrate. The child can decide how they want to show how the learning, because eventually a project is to test, giving a different methodology and helping the child to show what they have learned. So if the child wants to show through a PPT, they can be allowed. If they want to sing, or if they want to mime, or if they want to use sign language, within the group, there has to be cohesion. So what we do in our school is that for a given project, we have one group, but this group is not fixed. For the next project or a different subject, the child can be with a different set of children. So activity-based projects, or where they can use technology, or they can talk, or somebody at home, they can kind of, have a sheet where it has been made by the peers or the parents, and they can simply point out if they're having severe disabilities, they can use a stick to point out. So many things. Again, as I said, let the teacher give the flexibility to the learners to tell how they want to show what they have learned. Over a period of time, initially they may not be very successful, but let us not get deterred by negative outcomes or poor outcomes. Let us learn from the outcomes as we do in the formative and summative evaluation. We learn formative evaluation. So project the teacher can begin with on a very simple level. I just explained one which I had seen earlier. So they can pick up boards and show. They can pick up pre-written sign boards. So that word also they have learned is to read can be a project in itself. So the sky is the limit. You don't have to really be worried about the limitations of any project or the doability of a project. If it is not doable, it gives us an opportunity to learn how to do it. That depends from student to student level, primary, middle.
I think we need to collaborate with such people for making our schools more inclusive. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you very much. It has been a pleasure to be a part of CBSE. It's now been a long journey since 2001. I've been collaborating. Thank you very much for this opportunity.